we have to figure out what to do to promote and sustain long-term recovery. Thousands of people relapse all the time. If we can have one person become sober from drugs or alcohol or cocaine, that then has this ripple effect across their friends, their family, their life. I just kept remembering people relapsing and saying to me, I wish I had the skills that I could use to disrupt those thoughts. Role plays have always bothered me because it's what we've had. I would think, okay, let's pretend, you know, you and I are out in front of a convenience store having a cigarette and I'm your friend. And I keep thinking to myself, is the patient buying this? And then I look around my office and I'm like, this isn't a convenience store. So we're really asking people in therapy that are trying to work hard on skills to suspend their critical judgment and pretend they're in all these settings. So I kept thinking, how could we bring real-world situations where people relapse into the clinic or lab space to better understand relapse? So then when they're out in these situations in the real world, they're going to be better prepared and remember the skills they learned in a very similar setting.
I am Felicia Kleinpeter. I'm the CEO of Imagine Recovery New Orleans, an outpatient program in Uptown New Orleans.
I am Christopher O'Shea. I am the COO. As an addict and a person who works in the field with addicts, I was interested, but I wasn't too sure of how it would actually work.
The last project that I was working on was really trying to understand heroin craving. So we designed a virtual reality, what we call a heroin cave. It was a large scenario where you put on 3D glasses, interacting like they're at a party.
It is like doing experiential work that can't be done in a therapy office. So the value of it is tremendous.
It's pretty absurd that someone that's addicted to a substance can't afford treatment. That doesn't sit well with me. 10, 15 years ago, virtual reality headsets in our lab were $20,000, $30,000, $60,000 because that was the technology we had at the time. So Project Delta is an extension of the work that I've been doing for a long time. It's basically clicking a couple buttons on a smartphone and you now have a virtual bar, a virtual heroin shooting gallery, maybe a nightclub that you can now put people into those settings where they would relapse and teach them skills at low cost to the therapist and to the patient. Over the past few years, avatars have become really high definition, really human and lifelike. Several key elements need to be in these environments. One is the drug of choice. We need to get that right because that's what the person's used to. If a beer doesn't look like a beer or a joint doesn't look like a real joint, it doesn't really represent anything for that person. Everything's down to the high level of details. You can even see the track marks on the person's arm right here.
To be able to put them in a safe environment and let them stretch a little bit in the virtual world, I think is a significant safety net that we can use here at Imagine and have a conversation before actually being in the environment alone.
It's not a cure for addiction, but I believe it's going to be an effective tool to help us design therapies that are more effective for long-term change.
Whether it's substance abuse or whether it's eating disorder or it's anxiety or mental health, it's so relatable.
My youngest daughter has dyslexia, ADHD, and autism spectrum disorder. And she was in the lab and we put her in one of the virtual worlds because she wanted to try it. And I watched her behavior and was really noticing how she interacted in the scene. Then I began thinking, how do we leverage what we're doing to create environments to teach children and adults with autism communication, social skills, navigating their environment? People talk about a light bulb moment. It was like, whoa, if I understood what my daughter was experiencing to help me to have better interactions with her, that would mean the world to me because I don't know what she experiences. But that really drives me. I'm privileged, I love my job, I enjoy working with technology, but the long-term goal is to empower people for long-term change in their lives.